Hello, everyone. I'm Luis Jaramillo. I'm the director of the creative writing program at the New School, and I'm so pleased to have everyone here tonight. And we're so happy to welcome back our longtime friends from the National Book Foundation, the presenters of the National Book Awards. We're very honored to host tonight's event, and I think I'll just keep my comments brief because we have a lot of great readings and I'm not doing any of them, so I'm just gonna thank people. I'd like to thank Pam Tillis, Lori Lynn Turner, Ben Fama, Laura Kronk, Justin Sherwood, Randy Brown Jr., Julie Goldberg, Sylvan Simon, and Brian Case for all their hard work tonight here at the New School. Thanks so much, everyone. And as I'm sure all of you know, the National Book Foundation puts on a whole week of events. And this is just one of them, but I'd like to also thank Amy Gall, Leslie Shipman, Sherry Young, Meredith Andrews, and Courtney Gillette at the National Book Foundation. I'd also like to thank, in a very personal way, Harold Augenbraum, who has been an inspiration for me because of his wit and grace and charm, and one day I will be like him. This is bald, too, yes. So thank you, Harold. And so this is Harold's last year at the National Book Foundation. I don't know what we're going to do without you, but thank you so much. Tonight's host will be Alex Gilvarry. Alex Gilvarry is the author of the novel From the Memoirs of a Non-Enemy Combatant and was one of the National Book Foundation's 5 Under 35 honorees in 2014. His second novel, Eastman Was Here, is forthcoming from Viking. He is the artist in residence at Monmouth University where he teaches fiction. Now please help me in welcoming Alex to the stage. Thank you.
Thanks, Luis. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the National Book Award 2015 finalist reading. I'm so excited to be here, honored. This is one of my favorite readings of the year, where we get to honor and appreciate 20 writers working at the highest level of their craft. Each book is a tremendous, tremendous achievement, and I am in awe of every single one of them. Tonight is not about who wins. That's tomorrow night. Tomorrow night is about who wins, loses. That's tomorrow. Tonight is not about that. Tonight is about hearing these authors read from their books. And if you're here in this room, that means they have an audience full of passionate, imaginative readers ready to listen to them. Each nominee will read for approximately 5 minutes. Now, there was a rumor going around, which I would like to clear up at this point in the evening, and that is, I may have been guilty of spreading this rumor. I don't know. It is not true, that if one of the readers were to go over their allotted time, that they would be knocked out of the competition. That is not the case, so there's nothing to worry about. I thought that's how I remembered it in previous years. Like I said, this is one of my favorite nights, but I misremembered. I swore Louise Erdrich had gone over her time limit a couple years ago, but then I checked it on the internet. She actually won the National Book Award that year. That was proof that that is not the case. So this is how the evening will work. There will be 5 groups of 4 readers, 1 reader from each category: young people's literature, poetry, nonfiction, and fiction. Each reader will read for approximately 5 minutes, as I've already said. No consequences, guys. Now, if I may ask the finalists to please stand and face the audience, and let's give them a big, big round of applause, everybody. Thank you. Woo! what I like to see. All right, I'd like now to introduce our first group of readers. And it's going to go in this order. They'll remember the order. They'll come up in this order. In Young People's Literature, our finalist, Noelle Stevenson for Nimona, Harper Teen, HarperCollins Children Books, the publisher. Next, poetry finalist, Patrick Phillips, Elegy for a Broken Machine, Alfred A. Knopf. Nonfiction finalist, Tracy K. Smith, Ordinary Light, Alfred A. Knopf. And last fiction finalist, Hanya Yanagihara, A Little Life, Doubleday.
Hi, everybody. My name is Noelle Stevenson. I'm going to do a reading for my book, Nimona. It's going to be probably a little bit different from the other readings you're going to hear tonight, because this is a graphic novel. So I will be flipping through each panel and narrating the pictures that you see in each panel, making funny noises, making silly voices. So, you know, yeah, let's get into it. Nimona is a story of a shapeshifter who works as a sidekick for a supervillain. And in this chapter, they hatch a plan. But how does your shapeshifting work? It doesn't make any sense. It's magic. Can't you just accept it and move on? No. Ha, of course not. I'm Ballister Blackheart, and I only believe in science. Ah! Don't do that, it's weird. Don't do that, it's weird. Nimona, I swear, if you don't turn back right now, science! Ha! You're so easy to mess with. I can fire you anytime I want, you know. Sure, boss. Drat this store. What's wrong with it? Nothing, it's just very high security. I got to enter a series of very precise entry codes, which in turn activate the retinal scanners. Once the retinal scan is verified, the voice activation software goes online and... crash. Not high security enough for me. This is coming out of your paycheck. See, that right there, you just altered your own mask. That's impossible. Tell that to your door. Fine, so it's magic. What can't you do? What are the rules? Well, I can't turn into anything inanimate, for one. Unless I want to be inanimate, if you catch my drift. Two, I can only turn into creatures that actually exist. I can turn into any person, real or made up, but that's harder. Three, I'm allergic to bananas. Bananas? No matter what form I'm in, I don't know what it is. I get really bad hives. It's incredible. Hives? Not really. No, your powers, they're practically unlimited. Would you let me run some tests? If we could harness it. I'm nobody's lab rat. Got it, Buster. Clink. Nimona, are you okay? I'm not going to run any tests. Did someone else? Ooh, what's that? Does it kill people? Can I try it? Don't touch that. Time to snoop through the institution's stuff. Let's see what they consider top secret plans, shall we? Aw, these aren't secret plans. It's just a bunch of gibberish. What a ripoff. It's encoded. And that's good? They wouldn't be encoded unless they had something to hide. And you can crack it? I think so. Cool. Have you cracked it yet? No. Now? Nimona, it's been 6 minutes. This is boring. These things take time. It's not just going to... ding. Oh, you got it? What's it say? Move. I still have no idea what this means. Whoa. What? Jade root? The institution's using jade root? What? What's jade root? It's a very rare, very poisonous plant, and it's pretty much only used in dark sorcery. It's extremely corrosive and notoriously hard to control. The institution outlawed it a long time ago, and yet these plans suggest they've somehow got a large amount of it. What are the plans for? It seems they're trying to formulate a material that can store the jade root's poison without dissolving. And judging by the size of these containers, that's a lot of jade root. If it's so rare, then where are they getting it all? That's what I'm worried about. If they're growing it themselves, they risk contaminating the entire kingdom's crops. Crops? You're worried about the crops? If it starts poisoning everyone's food, then yes. Good point. Not to mention whatever they're planning on doing with all this jade root. So you're not crazy, huh? The institution really is up to no good. You thought I was crazy? No, crazy in a good way. Evil mad scientist kind of thing. Just stop. My point is, this proves you're right. The institution is totally crooked. I know I'm right. Yeah, and everyone else will too when we show them these. It's not that easy. The institution will discredit anything I say. Even if we did get it out, they'd find a way to cover it up. You do have a plan though, right? It's starting to come together, yes? Tell me! You have to promise to stick to it this time. Okay, I promise. Good. Then let's make some trouble for the institution. Yeah! Sip. Communications to director. This had better be important, Rudy. Turn on the news, director, channel 6. What's going on? These documents suggest that the institution has been hoarding large quantities of a substance known as jade root, a rare and deadly poisonous plant commonly associated with dark magic and which the institution itself has banned. Should we shut it down? If we cut it off now, they'll know we panicked. We'll only lend it credibility, let it run its course. Get a squad to the station and apprehend that anchorwoman as soon as it goes to commercial. Director! Is this true? Calm yourself, Sir Goldenloin. Of course it isn't true. How do you explain it then? Simple. It's Blackheart. But how? The shapeshifter, Goldenloin. I was waiting for something like this to happen. Well, turn it off. Get her out of there. We're sending a squad over now. Perhaps you'd like to go lend a hand? Viewers are advised to examine all food products before consumption for any signs of jade root poisoning. Coming up next, an expose on Sir Goldenloin's codpiece. What's he hiding under there? Does he really expect us to believe that his junk is that impressive? Shut it off right now! Royal Guard, don't move! Where is the anchor woman? She went to freshen up. She could be anywhere, but she's not getting away this time. There! After it! Oh, no, you don't, you cheeky little... Come on, man, this way! Run. Yeah! Gotcha! You caught the rat, sir? It's not a rat, it's a shapeshifter. What? Are you sure about that, sir? Because it looks like a rat painted pink to me. Nice try, though. You! Ha 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 ha. And that's it. Thank you, everybody.
And now for something completely different. I'm still looking at the comic right here. I've been to this reading many times. I live just across the bridge in Brooklyn, so I've been to this reading many times and seen many of my heroes on this stage and at this podium, so it's just an absolute joy to be here. Thank you all for coming. This is a love poem for my wife. It happens to be set at the dump, at a landfill, so not really like the roses and hearts kind of love poem. Mattress. We wrapped it in plastic and strapped it with duct tape. We wrestled it out to the curb, where dusted with snow, it slumped like a body. The garbage men fed through the maw of a truck that they drove out the tunnel to Jersey, to the dump where 1,000 gulls keened, hovering over that map of old stains where we dreamt and read and made love, where we sweated out fevers and fought and gave up, and once gazed at our blinking 3-day-old babies, never thinking it would end, full of maggots and fleas, full of suckling rats and blind moles, or whatever out there sleeps where we slept as it sloughs its guts into the dirt. This is a This is a poem for a beloved teacher of mine, Deborah Diggs, who I wish very much, it's in memory of Deborah, and I wish very much she was here tonight. The only thing you need to know, it's always nice when there's a fancy gloss. The only fancy gloss is that in Ovid, Philomel and Procne's saved when she's turned into a bird. Vesper Sparrow. All I can do to keep from believing where in truth your last steps led is think of the story you told us of Procne and how she was saved by the merciful gods. My vision of you on the shimmering ledge, turning in midair to a sparrow, your voice to its sweet vesper call, as you left the meaningless body below you, falling its meaningless fall. This poem is about my grandmother, and it has the rather unimaginative title, My Grandmother. So this is for Elizabeth Peacock Miller, whose daughter is in the house tonight. And the title goes right into the poem. My grandmother squints at the attendant with his white foam tray and waves him off like a starlet as she tells me, someday you'll understand, darling. Everyone will just vanish. Blue smoke exploding around her head when she laughs, then stares at her fingers in silence, flicking the ash. And I'm gonna end with a really short poem. I think like a lot of people, the violence around the world this week's been on my mind. So this is a sort of heathen's prayer. An attempt to kind of recover the idea of heaven. So I'm going to thank you all now. Just thank you very much for listening. It's short, so it'll go by really fast. Don't blink or you'll miss it. Heaven, it will be the past, and we'll live there together. Not as it was to live, but as it is remembered. It will be the past. We'll all go back together. Everyone we ever loved and lost and must remember, it will be the past and it will last forever. Thank you so much.
It's such an honor to be here tonight with so many marvelous writers, and thank you for coming. So I'm going to read just a little snippet of a chapter from the memoir called A Strange After. And it's a book that's thinking about race and religion, but it's also thinking very much about my mother. And this is a chapter that takes place just after her death. I believe she wanted to keep living, but she wasn't hung up on it. It makes sense now. The way she'd said that God could heal her, meaning it was within his power, up to him, just as he could choose not to, and instead to call her home, to let her live in the ever after she always believed was beyond this one. Having her there made it real, not the frivolous cartoon place I'd tried to convince my cousin Nina of when we were kids. The one with gold-paved streets and block after block of identical mansions, but some place with purpose. A place where my mother's faith and her goodwill might be reunited with her spirit's original amplitude, so that she was large, larger than all of us who grieved her, larger than the world as she had known to imagine it, or the God in whom she had trusted, who was larger and stranger than she'd known to imagine him. In the days preceding her funeral, the house was full, and we moved through the blur of actions that always fills in the space between someone's death and our ritual for saying goodbye. I was surprised at what it felt like, surprised enough that I wondered if what I was feeling was really what I felt, an empty, groggy disbelief coupled with an unexpected relief, as if the long buildup to letting go was almost worse than the silent freefall of afterward. That wasn't it exactly. But at least, finally, there was a name for what I felt, grief, a shape to try to fit it into. There were words, sanctioned words, I might offer or collect like the dull, heavy coins of that new realm. There were times, lots of them, when someone would offer to pray with me. I never said no. I possessed no inclination to take God to task for my mother's death. Didn't find it difficult to think of her death as something that had happened to her rather than me, some twist or fold in her destiny that had only just brushed against mine. My mother had been so adamant about the afterlife that she'd forbidden us from making a shrine of her grave. Bury me in a simple pine box and don't visit my body in the ground. I won't be there. She'd said it almost happily, triumphantly, as if doing such things might constitute proof that heaven is real. And we came as close to doing what she'd asked as the funeral industry would allow, issuing the brushed titanium Cadillac of coffins and choosing instead the plainest oak. At the burial, we stood around the gravesite in our dark mourning clothes. Pastor Ganey spoke, I'm sure, movingly, powerfully, but my mind would not stay still. Is she with us now, or has she already gone? And if she goes, can she ever come back? I thought of her watching our flimsy bodies, our bowed heads and put-upon shoulders, with a tenderness and a clarity beyond our ability to grasp. How miniature our lives must have looked from there, and how utterly bereft we must have seemed, standing over the hole in the earth that would never contain her. Look up, I imagined her saying. Look up and see how much distance waits beyond this life. Be happy for me. Be glad. In the first moments after her death, when it was clear that she was gone, I looked up at the ceiling above where her body lay. I'd been thinking about what people say happens when a person dies, how the spirit hovers in the room a while, watching from above, taking in the fact that it has come free of the body that was once its anchor. November 14th, 1994, a rainy Monday night. I wanted her to see my face as she floated off toward whatever awaited her, as if that gesture might serve as a signal that I believed she was on her way to that elsewhere, the tunnel and the light, the other side. But I hadn't given any thought to what it would feel like to me, staring up at what my eyes told me was nothing at all. In the weeks following the funeral, after all the distant family had left and routine began to reassert itself, I found it surprising that there was space for so many of my ordinary moods, stretches of any given day when everything or almost everything felt normal or almost normal. But then I'd catch myself thinking of my mother as if she were there, just a room away, and the reality of her death crept back in like the mortar between bricks, holding everything in place in a strange after. After that no longer included her. Back when I was in grade school and fascinated by anything old-fashioned, I'd convinced my mother to buy me a few kerosene lamps. I liked to read by them, even though their light was flickering. It made me feel like I could step inside history and live there a while, not my same self, but not quite a stranger either. One dark winter afternoon, when one of the kerosene lamps was burning in the living room, I put down my book and wandered into the next room where my mother was blocking together pieces for a quilt. The Phil Donahue show was on the television with the sound turned down low. Go back and check on that lamp, she'd said after a few minutes. Okay, I'd replied, but the TV caught my attention and I didn't go. Is that lamp all right? She'd asked after another minute, and certain that it was, I told her, yes, it's fine. A minute later, something told me to get up and go check. It was a quiet but urgent feeling, and I jumped up to make sure everything was in order. When I got to the living room, I saw a column of flame licking the ceiling. My mother had the presence of mind to cap the top of the lamp with a dish resting on the same table, and luckily the flame consented to being snuffed out, though it left a dark, sooty ring on the ceiling. It took a long time for the spot to fade. Sometimes, after Mom had died, I'd be going along as if everything were fine, as if the day were any ordinary day. And then the fact of her death, no, not simply the fact of her death, but rather the facts of her death and her life, her presence in this world and the presence her absence made, the whole of what I remembered or lacked, everything she gave and left, and what in leaving she took. The fact of all that, like a column of threat and promise and light, would flare bright and hot in my mind. Thank you.
So I've memorized all 720 pages, which is why I don't have a copy of the book. No, you actually just, you make Xeroxes. So thank you all so much for being here, and I'm thrilled to be in this company. And I'm going to be reading a little bit from the middle of the book, and this is shortly after the protagonist, Jude, ends a disastrous first relationship. There were two ways of forgetting. For many years, he had envisioned, unimaginatively, a vault. And at the end of the day, he would gather the images and sequences and words that he didn't want to think about again and open the heavy steel door only enough to hurry them inside, closing it quickly and tightly. But this method wasn't effective. The memory seeped out anyway. The important thing, he came to realize, was to eliminate them, not just to store them. So he had invented some solutions. For small memories, little slights, insults, you relive them again and again until they were neutralized, until they became near meaningless with repetition, or until you could believe that they were something that had happened to someone else and you had just heard about it. For larger memories, you held the scene in your head like a film strip, and then you began to erase it, frame by frame. Neither method was easy. You couldn't stop in the middle of your erasing and examine what you were looking at, for example. You couldn't start scrolling through parts of it and hope you wouldn't get ensnared in the details of what had happened, because you, of course, would. You had to work at it every night until it was completely gone. Though they never disappear completely, of course, but they were at least more distant. They weren't things that followed you, wraith-like, tugging at you for attention, jumping in front of you when you ignored them, demanding so much of your time and effort that it became impossible to think of anything else. In fallow periods, the moments before you fell asleep, the minutes before you were landing after an overnight flight, when you weren't awake enough to do work and weren't tired enough to sleep, they would reassert themselves. And so it was best to imagine then a screen of white, huge and light-lit and still, and hold it in your mind like a shield. In the weeks following the beating, he worked on forgetting Caleb. Before going to bed, he went to the door of his apartment and, feeling foolish, tried forcing his old set of keys into the locks to assure himself that they didn't fit, that he really was once again safe. He set and reset the alarm system he'd had installed, which was so sensitive that even passing shadows triggered a flurry of beeps. And then he lay awake, his eyes open in the dark room, concentrating on forgetting. But it was so difficult. There were so many memories from those months that stabbed at him that he was overwhelmed. He heard Caleb's voice saying things to him. He saw the expression on Caleb's face as he stared at his unclothed body. He felt the horrid blank airlessness of his fall down the staircase, and he crunched himself into a knot and put his hands over his ears and closed his eyes. Finally, he would get up and go to his office at the other end of the apartment and work. He had a big case coming up, and he was grateful for it. He His days were so occupied that he had little time to think of anything else. For a while, he was hardly going home at all, just 2 hours to sleep and an hour to shower and change, until one evening he'd had an episode at work, a bad one, the first time he ever had. The night janitor had found him on the floor and had called the building security department, who had called the firm's chairman, a man named Peterson Tremaine, who had called Lucian, who was the only one he had told what to do in case something like this should happen. Lucian had called Andy, and then both he and the chairman had come into the office and waited with him for Andy to arrive. He had seen them, seen their feet, and even as he had gasped and writhed on the ground, he had tried to find the energy to beg them to leave, to reassure them that he was fine, that he just needed to be left alone. But they hadn't left, and Lucian had wiped the vomit from his mouth and then sat on the floor near his head and held his hand, and he had been so embarrassed he had almost cried. Later, he had told them again and again that it was nothing, that this happened all the time. But they had made him take the rest of the week off, and the following Monday, Lucian had told him that they were making him go home at a reasonable hour, midnight on the weekdays, 9 p.m. on the weekends. Lucian, he'd said, frustrated, this is ridiculous. I'm not a child. He had fought and fought with him, but it hadn't made a difference. At midnight, his office lights abruptly clicked off, and he had at last resigned himself to going home when he had been told. Since the Caleb incident, he had barely been able to talk to Harold. Even seeing him was a kind of torture. This made Harold and Julia's visits, which were increasingly frequent, challenging. He could feel Harold trying to treat him the same as he had, but something had shifted. No longer did Harold harass him about Rose and Pritchard. No longer did he ask him about what it was like to abet corporate malfeasance. And he certainly never mentioned the possibility that he might settle down with someone. Now his questions are about how he felt. How was he? How was he feeling? How were his legs? Had he been tiring himself out? Had he been using the chair a lot? Did he need help with anything? And he always answered the exact same way. Fine, fine, fine. No, no, no. Thank you.
And now for our second group of finalists. In Young People's Literature, we have finalist Neal Shusterman for Challenger Deep, HarperCollins Children's Books. Poetry finalist Ada Limon, Bright Dead Things, Milkweed Editions. Nonfiction finalist Carla Power, If the Oceans Were Ink, An Unlikely Friendship and a Journey to the Heart of the Quran, Henry Halton Company. And fiction finalist Adam Johnson, Fortune Smiles, Random House.
Challenger Deep is a story about a teenage boy who goes on a journey across the ocean to the Marianas Trench to dive down to Challenger Deep, the deepest place in the world, in a very surrealistic voyage on a pirate ship. But really, it's about a teenage boy who is beginning to fall into the depths of schizophrenia. It was inspired by my own son Brendan's experiences when he faced his illness and was in the depths himself. And he said to me, Dad, sometimes it feels like I'm at the bottom of the ocean screaming at the top of my lungs and nobody can hear me. I want to write a book about that feeling. I'm going to read two short sections, one at the very beginning, and the second is my interpretation of what it's like to go through a bipolar episode. Chapter one, Fee-Fi-Fo-Fum. There are two things you know. One, you were there. Two, you couldn't have been there. Holding these two incompatible truths together takes skill at juggling. Of course, juggling requires a third ball to keep the rhythm smooth. That third ball is time, which bounces much more wildly than any of us would like to believe. The time is 5 a.m. You know this because there is a battery-powered clock on your bedroom wall that ticks so loudly you sometimes have to smother it with a pillow. And yet, while it's 5 in the morning here, it's also 5 in the evening somewhere in China, proving that incompatible truths make perfect sense when seen with global perspective. Your sister sleeps in the next room, and in the room beyond that, your parents. Your dad is snoring. Soon, your mom will nudge him enough to make him roll over, and the snoring will cease, maybe until dawn. All of this is normal, and there's great comfort in that. Across the street, a neighbor's sprinklers come on, hissing loud enough to drown out the ticking of the clock. You can smell the sprinkler mist through the open window, mildly chlorinated, heavily fluoridated. Isn't it nice to know that the neighborhood lawns will have healthy teeth? The hiss of the sprinklers is not the sound of snakes. And the painted dolphins on your sister's wall cannot plot deadly schemes. And the scarecrow's eyes do not see. Even so, there are nights where you can't sleep because these things you juggle take all of your concentration. You fear that one ball might drop, and then what? You don't dare imagine beyond that moment because waiting in that moment is the captain. He's patient, and he waits. Always. Even before there was a ship, there was the captain. This journey began with him, you suspect it will end with him, and everything between is the powdery meal of windmills that might be giants grinding bones to make their bread. Tread lightly or you'll wake them. Chapter 65, The Darkness Beyond. What do I see when I close my eyes? Sometimes there is a darkness there that goes beyond anything I can describe. Sometimes it is glorious, and sometimes it is terrifying, and I rarely know what it's going to be. When it's glorious, I want to live in that place where the stars are just marking a vast, unreachable shell, like they used to believe in days of old, the inside surface of a giant eyelid. And when I peel back the lid, there's a darkness that truly goes on forever. But it's not darkness at all. It's just that our eyes have no way to see that kind of light. If we could, it would blind us. So that eyelid, it protects us. Instead, we see stars, the only hint of the light we can never reach. And yet I go there. I push past the stars into that dark light, and you can't imagine how it feels. Velvet and licorice caressing every sense. It melts into a liquid you plunge through. It evaporates into the air that you breathe, and you soar. You don't need wings because it supports you of its own accord, of its own will resonating with yours. And you feel not only that you can do anything, but that you are anything. Everything. You move through everything, and your heartbeat becomes a pulse of all things alive, all at once, and the silence between each beat is the stillness of the things that exist but do not live. The stone, the sand, the rain. And you realize that it is all necessary. The silence must exist for there to be a beat. And you are both those things, the presence and the absence. And that knowledge is so magnificent you can't hold it in, and it drives you to share it, but you don't have words to describe it. And without the words, without a way to share the feeling, it breaks you, because your mind just isn't large enough to hold what you've tried to fit in it. But it's not always like that. Sometimes the darkness beyond is not glorious at all. It truly is an absolute absence of light, a clawing, needy tar that pulls you down. You drown, but you don't. It turns you to lead so you sink faster in its viscous embrace. It robs you of hope and even the memory of hope. It makes you think you've always felt like this, and there's no place to go but down, where it slowly, ravenously digests your will, distilling it into the ebony crude of nightmares. And you know the darkness beyond despair just as intimately as you know the soaring heights, because in this and in all universes, there is balance. You can't have the one without facing the other, and sometimes you think you can take it because the joy is worth the despair. And sometimes you know you can't take it, and how did you ever think you could? And there is the dance, strength and weakness, confidence and desolation. What do I see when I close my eyes? I see beyond darkness, and it is immeasurably grand, both above me and below. Thank you.
This night is amazing, truly amazing. I'm going to read three poems. And the first one is about the day before the Kentucky Derby when all of the female horses race the Oaks Day. How to triumph like a girl. I like the lady horses best, how they make it all look easy, like running 40 miles per hour is as fun as taking a nap or grass. I like their lady horse swagger after winning. Ears up, girls, ears up. But mainly, let's be honest, I like that they're ladies. As if this big, dangerous animal is also a part of me. That somewhere inside the delicate skin of my body, there pumps an 8-pound female horse heart. Giant with power, heavy with blood. Don't you want to believe it? Don't you want to lift my shirt and see the huge, beating, genius machine that thinks, no, it knows, it's going to come in first. Thank you. This poem for the ladies. This poem is about, when I was starting this book, I had just lost my stepmother to cancer, and it was a home death. And this poem is about that experience. The Riveter. What I didn't say when she asked me why I knew so much about dying was that for me, it was work. When Dad called to say we had a month, I made a list. I called in my team to my office in a high rise, those rosies of know-how, those that had lost someone loved, those that had done the assembly line of a home death, and said, what is this about not keeping her on TPN? One woman who was still soft with sadness said, it depends on whether she wants to die of heart failure or drown in her own fluids. I nodded and wrote that down, like this was a meeting about a client who wasn't happy. What about hospice? I asked. They said, they'll help, but your dad and you guys will do most of it. I put a star by that. We had a plan of action. When this happens, we do this. When that happens, we do that. But what I forgot was that it was our plan, not hers, not the one doing the dying. This was a plan for those who still had a next. See, our job was simple, keep on living. Her job was harder, the hardest. Her job, her work, was to let the machine of survival break down, make the factory fail, to know that this war was winless, to know that she would single-handedly destroy us all. I'm going to close with a poem. That's a true story. And all you need to know about it is that it was at a time in my life where I had chosen to be with an older poet, and this was probably the moment when I realized that that was maybe a mistake. Service. Somewhere outside of Albuquerque, I was all fed up with the stories about your ex-girlfriend's guest billboard in New York City. And to make matters worse, I had to pee like a racehorse, or like a girl who had too much to drink way too far from home. You stopped at a friend's body shop to talk about a buddy who was stuck someplace in Mexico. You were talking, pulling strings, and taking pulls off a brown bottle, and no one told me where the restroom was. So I walked back to where the hot rods were displayed like dogs ready for a fight, baring their grills like teeth. I was hungry. The air smelled like hot gasoline and that sweet carnation smell of oil and coolant. A girl pit bull came and circled me as I circled the cars. She sniffed my ankles like I was her kin or on some kind of rescue mission. You were still talking, not a glance in the direction of me and the bitch working our ways around the souped-up Corvettes and the power tools. The pit was glossy, well cared for, a queen of the car shop. And when she widened her hind legs and squatted to pee all over one of the car's dropped canvases, I took it as a challenge. That strong yellow stream seemed to be saying, girl, no one's gonna tell me when to take a leak, when to bow down, when not to bite. So right then, in the dim lights of the strange garage, I lifted my skirt and pissed like the hard bitch I was. Thank you.
It's absolutely amazing to be here. Thank you. Given the events of the last few days, I've been flip-flopping on what to read tonight and whether I should read something serious or not. And given that everything else we seem to be reading about Islam these days seems grave and sad, I thought I'd read something a little lighter. This is from If the Oceans Were Ink, my book's about studying the Quran with an old friend, a traditional Islamic scholar, Sheikh Akram. And this comes from this scene where I finally take my two daughters, Nick and Julia, to lunch at the Sheikh's house. On the appointed day, we march up to the brick house with white trim, past the family Volkswagen, and rang the bell. I'd briefed Julia and Nick on the bus from London. We'd just be seeing the Sheikh's two youngest daughters and his wife. There wouldn't be computer games or pasta on the menu. I trotted out the standard speeches about being on their best behavior and remembering their manners. They did, bless them. The only gaffe I detected came not from rudeness, but an excess of enthusiasm. At the last minute, Nick had decided to bring her own gift for the Sheikh's daughters, a palm-sized snake figurine she had won the day before on the two-penny game at the amusement arcade on Brighton Pier. As we walked in the door, she pulled it out of her jeans pocket and thrust it towards a perplexed Aisha. This is for you, trumpeted Nick. And I got it, arms thrown out, legs planted in a conquering hero stance, from gambling. I winced. Gambling is haram, the Quran explicitly warning that, quote, Satan only wants to sow hostility and hatred among you with wine and gambling. Yet here was Nick, barely inside the front door, bragging about her takings like the whole cast of Ocean's 11. Boasting, too, was un-Islamic. Don't swagger around on earth, cautions the Quran, for God loves no pompous braggart, and moderate your stride and lower your voice. To my relief, Aisha and Fatima either didn't notice or were just too polite to comment. Besides, Nick's bumptiousness was soon drowned out by our admiration of the house. My 11-year-old daughter, Julia, exuded high-gear politeness, like a Victorian vicar's wife hopped up on sugar. So much light, she exclaimed. So lovely. And you have a garden. Isn't it lovely? It was. They'd redone the living room since I'd last visited, and the effect was unwittingly chic. Dingy carpet had been stripped away in favor of wooden floorboards. Teacups dangled neatly on hooks in a china cupboard. The bright white of the walls glowed in the sun, making the room's sole decoration mesmeric in its simplicity. It was a single word, in elegant calligraphic black, Allah. Their house was so clean, Julia later exclaimed, so tidy. So spoke a kid whose own home was filled with the noisy chaos of a patchwork aesthetic, a place stuffed with Oriental carpets and Egyptian copper and Pakistani mirror work, all beautiful, but also all testimony to the magpie tendencies I'd inherited from my father. The simplicity of the Sheikh's house shocked her. It reflected a sensibility of certainty. The surroundings suggested the resident's streamlined spirit, like a magazine devoted to simplifying your life or one of those stores selling organizers for your closet. The Sheikh's worldview had an appealing promise of order about it. Looking at the luminous Allah on the wall, I was reminded that this order was built solely out of words. Among non-Muslims, it's a cliche to say a writer or poet is immersed in language. But a secular relationship to words, passionate as it may be, doesn't begin to touch Sheikh Akram's. His life is built of them. The divine words of the Quran provide the bedrock of his existence. Growing up in a village without TV or movies or billboards or museums, he received all information of the outside world verbally, either on the radio or on a page. As a young boy, Akram learned about the world from the Quran and later from books of Persian poetry. When he went off to Nadwa, his madrasa, his immersion in words only grew through his study of classical Arabic grammar, a core subject in any madrasa. It provides the Islamic scholar tools to parse the meaning in Allah's pronouncements. Poetry was his sole artistic pleasure, his Star Wars and his Citizen Kane, his Sergeant Pepper and his Mona Lisa. His memory stored reams of verse, so he'd often lace his lectures with a couplet from Saadi or a bit of a Hafez Ghazal to drive home a point or revive flagging attention. And daily, after dawn prayers, he allowed himself a few moments to read a poem or two. Poetry, he once told me, makes the heart soft, especially when read in the morning.
Good evening. I'm Adam Johnson. It's a particular honor to be counted among so many fine writers. I feel very, very fortunate to be here. My book is called Fortune Smiles, and it's a short story collection. And I'm going to read just a page from a short story called Dark Meadow. A knock at the door wakes me midday. Since I sleep fully clothed, I'm able to answer right away. By sleeping with your clothes on, you don't need to disturb a perfectly made bed or even fold the bed back into the couch. When I open the door, a police officer is standing there. He nods toward the yard. "Those are some pretty serious flowers," he says. "They're from the lady that used to live here," I tell him. "I'm Officer Hernandez," he says, "Jaime Hernandez, with the Crimes Against Minors Task Force. A colleague of mine, Sergeant Rengsdorf, said I might speak with you. He said you helped de-encrypt a couple laptops a while back, that you helped him solve a kiddie porn case." Just then, Ronza comes walking by. "You finally busting that creep show," she calls out. "Someone's been peeping in the neighborhood, and I knew it was him. I could see it in his fucked up eyes." The cop lifts his hand in a semi-salute that says, "I heard you, ma'am. Thanks for the input. But Ronza isn't done. Look at him," she demands. "He's got Ricky Ticky Tavi eyes." When she's gone, Officer Hernandez offers a knowing smile. "There's one in every neighborhood," he says. But he is now studying my eyes. "Please," I say, "come in." He steps inside. "You just move in?" he asks, and I almost tell him that I've been living here for 7 years. Instead, I shut my mouth and watch him sweep his eyes along the empty white walls and blank refrigerator and neatly made fold-out bed. "You never really get settled," I tell him. "When you do, it's time to move again," he says, staring at the bookcase that houses my National Geographic magazines, rows and rows of yellow spines. We stand at the kitchen counter. "Glass of water," I ask, "or a half pint of milk?" That's a lot of magazines, he says. I didn't know they still published that one. I have a lifetime subscription, I say. What did that set you back, he asks, hollowly, for he is really scrutinizing the contents of my fridge when I open it. There's nothing to see, just rows and rows of neatly stacked cartons of milk. I received the subscription as a prize when I was a boy in the Sea Scouts. I was our troop scout of the year, though I didn't do anything special to earn it. It was more of a consolation prize, really. The cop returns his gaze to me. Sea Scouts? It's just like the Boy Scouts, but on water. You learn navigation and maritime skills. The troop I was in doesn't exist anymore. It disbanded after our troop leader took his life. He hiked up to Penga Canyon and hung himself. The cop watches me fold open the milk carton spout. Sorry to hear that, he says. I'm sure his legacy lives on. I take a swig of milk. Well, I say, the magazines keep coming. Hernandez ponders the tiny milk carton in my hand. You know they sell that stuff by the gallon. I like to take things in increments, I tell him. Thank you.
After our next group, we will have a short intermission, cleverly placed in the middle of the evening to prevent zoning out, because that happens. Our next group of finalists, in young people's literature, we have Steve Sheinkin, Most Dangerous, Daniel Ellsberg, and The Secret History of the Vietnam War from Roaring Brook Press. Poetry finalist, Robin Coste Lewis, Voyage of the Sable Venus, Alfred A. Knopf. Nonfiction finalist, Cy Montgomery, The Soul of an Octopus, Atria Books, a division of Simon & Schuster. And fiction finalist, Lauren Groff, Fates and Furies, Riverhead Books.
Thank you. It's an amazing honor to be here with this group of writers. And I am going to, my book is nonfiction, and the main character is named Daniel Ellsberg, and I'm going to pick a spot right in the middle of the story. He, to this point in his life, he's been a consummate insider. He was a Harvard PhD, a Marine officer. He worked for the Pentagon, and really was, though he's not famous, one of the early architects of the Vietnam War. But at this point, it's 1969. He's really turned against the war, possibly ready to do something big. And he has access to these top secret documents that reveal years, decades of government lies about the war. And I don't think it's too much of a spoiler to say he released them. He leaked them to the press, and that really became, and is to this day, really controversial what he did. But this is a little bit before that, and it's one of those little moments. I love these little moments where life can change. Ellsberg stood on the sidewalk outside of Philadelphia courthouse, feeling like an absolute fool. In front of him marched a group of anti-war demonstrators. They were carrying signs, chanting slogans, passing out leaflets. Cast your whole vote, Ellsberg thought. Not a slip of paper merely, but your whole influence. He couldn't get the words out of his head. They were from Henry David Thoreau's famous essay, Civil Disobedience, written in 1849. Thoreau, to protest slavery in what he saw as America's unjust war in Mexico, had refused to pay taxes. He'd been arrested and jailed, but had no regrets. Cast your whole vote, your whole influence. It was an inspiring idea, but he still felt like a fool. Ellsberg had flown across the country to attend the War Resisters International Conference, held at a college near Philadelphia. He thought he'd be going to lectures and discussions, and instead, everyone had trooped to the courthouse to demonstrate. Inside, an activist named Bob Eaton was being sentenced to prison for resisting the draft. Ellsberg had tried to think of an excuse to duck out. Could he say he was sick? And then do what, hide in his room all weekend? His only previous peace march had been the one with Patricia in 1965, and he'd only gone to that one hoping for a date. He felt the same fear now that he had then. What if his picture showed up in the newspaper? He could hear the mocking laughter of colleagues in Washington. But he knew how he felt about the war. He looked around. There were no TV cameras or reporters, no police in sight. People hurried past on their way to work, hardly seeming to notice the demonstrators. Ellsberg stepped out to join the rally. Why are we doing this, he thought at first. What am I doing here? It seemed preposterous. Way to confront the colossal power of the United States government. He watched the other protesters marching, waving signs. He picked up a stack of anti-war leaflets and held them out to people passing by. And suddenly, to his surprise, he began to enjoy himself. The threat of being cut off, of being thrust out from the club of insiders, had always terrified Ellsberg. And the club had very definite rules. You could not have the confidence of powerful men and be trusted with their confidences if there was any prospect that you would challenge their policies in public, he later explained. It was the sacred code of the insider. He had lived by that code his entire life. This was the moment he crossed the line. He held out leaflets to people passing by. Most didn't take them. It didn't matter. I was no longer held in line by that fear, he said. I was about to become a dangerous person to know. The day after the courthouse demonstration, Ellsberg sat in the back row of a packed auditorium at the War Resisters Conference. A young activist named Randy Keeler stood in front of the group. Yesterday, our friend Bob went to jail, Keeler began. Last month, David Harris went to jail. Our friends Warren and John and Terry and many others are already in jail. Keeler stopped to clear his throat. From the back, Ellsberg could see the tears in the speaker's eyes. I'm not really as sad about it as I may seem, Keeler said. There's something really beautiful about it, and I'm very excited that I'll be invited to join them soon. The audience knew that Keeler was facing jail time himself for refusing to cooperate with the draft. A few people began to clap, then a few more, then everyone stood and cheered. I can look forward to jail without any remorse or fear, Keeler continued, and that's because I know that everyone here and lots of people around the world, like you, will carry on. Everyone was clapping and cheering. Many were crying. Ellsberg fell back into his seat, suddenly dizzy, short of breath. He had to get out. He needed space. He pushed out of the row and ran into the hall to the men's room. He turned on the light, stumbled to the far wall, slid down to the tile floor, and sobbed. We're eating our young, he said to himself. These young men and women in the auditorium was just like the friends he had known in the Marines, patriots, fighting for their country. The best young Americans were going to war or going to jail. What about his own son, Robert, now 13? Would the war still be raging in 5 years when Robert was draft age? Ellsberg sat on the floor. He could not stop shaking. Finally, gaining control, he took a few deep breaths. He stood and stepped to a sink and splashed water on his face. He looked at himself in the mirror. Now, he asked, what can I do to help end this war? Thanks.
Good evening. I too am very honored to be here. I don't understand the magic that took place to land me here, but I'm very grateful. Thank you. I'm going to start with a poem that is written in a childhood language. I was born in a very beautiful place that was ornamented with hummingbirds and bougainvillea and palm trees and cows and dirt roads and good people. We now call this place Compton, California. It is still a place that is ornamented with hummingbirds and bougainvillea and cows and very good people. Most of those people when I was growing up was from Louisiana, and every summer people went back home to New Orleans, and the children would come back with secret languages, and it was a wonderful way that children asserted their authority into adult culture. And I'm reading it for several reasons, but one is I want to congratulate all the finalists. I'm very honored to be in your company. It's called Dog Talk, and I'll translate it after. Dog Talk. We be but broke a bevery be syllable bubble. A bower ma bowels but broke the bim a ben a bope a bin the bim for bore a bear or bore wa barterbur or bore sabid or bore fabood. A banser burrs, kabeshtabins, nabame, sabikribits. We be babent a binklabesh. A bimba braced a bit, the ben iba rebased a bit, about the bus abame, tabime. This is what I call dog talk for dummies. It's not in the book, but I'm going to translate it for you. We broke every syllable. Our mouths broke them and opened them for air or water or seed or food. Answers, questions, names, secrets. We bent English, embraced it, then erased it at the same time. Summer. Last summer, two discreet young snakes left their skin on my small porch, two mornings in a row. Being postmodern now, I pretended as if I did not see them nor understand what I knew to be circling inside me. Instead, every hour I told my son to stop with his incessant back chat. I peeled a banana and cursed God, his arrogance, his gall, to still expect our devotion after creating love and mosquitoes. I showed my son the papery dead skin so he could know too what it feels like when something shows up at your door twice, telling you what you already know. And then I'm going to end with a poem called Plantation, which is also a kind of love poem. Patrick, thank you for reading love poems. This love poem is the kind of love poem that is interrupted by history. And I hope is a meditation on how complicated intimacy can be and yet love still prevails. Plantation. And then one morning we woke up embracing on the bare floor of a large cage. To keep you happy, I decorated the bars. Because you had never been hungry, I knew I could tell you the black side of my family owned slaves. I realize this is perhaps the one reason why I love you, because I told you this and you still wanted to kiss me. We laughed when I said plantation, fell into our chairs when I said cane. There were fingers on the floor and the split bodies of women who had been torn apart by horses during the Inquisition. You'd said, well, I'll be damned. Every now and then you'd change from a prancing black buck into a small high yellow girl, pigtailed patent leather, eye spinning gossamer, begging for egg salad or banana pudding. Or just as quickly, you'd become the girl's mother, pulling yourself away from yourself. Because my whole head was covered with a heaving beehive, you thought I didn't notice. I noticed. I cried, honey. And then you were 14, and you had grown a glorious steel cock under your skirt. To brag, you rubbed yourself against me. Then your tongue was inside my mouth, and I wanted to say, please ask me first, but it was your tongue, so who cared suddenly about your poor manners? We had books, and a waterfall was falling in the corner. I didn't tell you, I couldn't remember what that thing was you said to me once, that tender thing you'd said I should never forget. The moment you said it, I forgot it. I wondered if you thought we were lost. We weren't lost, we were lost. And meanwhile, all I could think about were the innumerable ways I would have loved to have eaten you, how being devoured can make one cry. And I hoped you liked the fresh, pleasant taste of juiced cane. You pulled my pubic bone toward you. I didn't say, it's still broken. I didn't tell you, there's still this crack. It was sore, but I stayed silent because you were smiling. You said, the bars look pretty, baby. Then rubbed your hind legs up against me. Thank you so much.
On a rare warm day in March 2011, when snow was melting into mud in New Hampshire, I traveled to Boston to the New England Aquarium to meet an octopus named Octavia. The first octopus I met was named Athena, and I'd like to tell you about her. Aquarist Scott Dowd agreed to help me meet her, and this is what happened. Athena is about 2.5 years old and weighs roughly 40 pounds, Scott explains as he lifts the heavy lid covering her tank. I mount the 3 short steps of a small movable stair and lean over to see. She stretches about 5 feet long. By the time Scott has propped open the tank cover, Athena has already oozed from the far corner of her 560-gallon tank to investigate us. Holding to the corner with 2 arms, she unfurls the others, her whole body red with excitement, and reaches to the surface. Her white suckers stretch up like the palm of a person reaching out for a handshake. May I touch her? I ask Scott. Sure, he says. I take off my wristwatch, remove my scarf, roll up my sleeves, and plunge both arms elbow deep into the shockingly cold 47-degree water. Twisting, gelatinous, her arms boil up from the water, reaching for mine. Instantly, both my hands and forearms are engulfed by dozens of soft, questing suckers. Not everyone would like this. The naturalist and explorer William Beebe found the touch of the octopus repulsive. Fear of the octopus lies deep in the human psyche. No animal is more savage in causing the death of man in the water, Pliny the Elder wrote in AD 79, for it struggles with him by coiling round him, and it swallows him with sucker cups and drags him asunder. But Athena's suction is gentle, though insistent. It pulls me like an alien's kiss. Her melon-sized head bobs to the surface, and her left eye, octopuses have a dominant eye, like people have dominant hands, swivels in its socket to meet mine. Her black pupil is a fat hyphen in a pearly globe. Its expression reminds me of the look in the eyes of paintings of Hindu gods and goddesses, serene, all-knowing, heavy with wisdom, and stretching back beyond time. She's looking right at you, Scott says. As I hold her glittering gaze, I instinctively reach to touch her head. As supple as leather, as tough as steel, as cold as night, Victor Hugo wrote of the octopus's flesh. But to my surprise, her head is silky and softer than custard. Her skin is flecked with ruby and silver, a night sky reflected on the wine-dark sea. As I stroke her with my fingertips, her skin goes white beneath my touch. And she seems as curious about me as I am about her. Slowly, she transfers her grip on me from the smaller outer suckers at the tips of her arms to the larger, stronger ones nearer her head. I am now bent at a 90-degree angle, folded like a half-open book as I stand on the little step stool. I realize what is happening. She's pulling me steadily into her tank. Thank you.
Thank you so much for this night. It's been magnificent to listen to all these wonderful finalists. So when I was thinking about what to read tonight, I thought I didn't want to read anything that had spoilers in it, and I didn't want to read anything that had sex in it because I don't know you yet. And that left very little. So tonight I'm going to read from the backstory of one of the main characters in this book named Mathilde. Mathilde had one picture of herself from when she was tiny. Fat cheeks, gold hair. The only child in a large Breton family. Her bangs clipped from her face in a barrette, scarves on her neck, lacy socks to her ankles. Her grandparents fed her galette, cider, caramels with sea salt. The kitchen had rounds of camembert ripening in the cabinet. It could knock you down to open the door unsuspecting. Her mother was a fishwife at the market in Nantes. She'd rise in the blue night and drive to the city and come home mid-morning with her hands chapped and glittering with scales, cold to the bone from contact with ice. Her face was delicate, but she had no education. Her husband had wooed her with his leather jacket, his pompadour, his motorcycle. Small things to trade for a life, but at the time they seemed powerful. Mathilde's father was a stonemason, and his family had lived in the same house in Notre-Dame-des-Landes for 12 generations. Mathilde was conceived during the Revolution of May, 1968. Though her parents were far from radical, there was so much excitement in the air that they didn't know how to express themselves except animally. When it was impossible for the girl's mother to hide her pregnancy, they were married with orange blossoms in her hair, a slice of coconut cake in the freezer. Mathilde's father was quiet, loved few things. Putting stone on stone, the wine he made in his garage, his hunting dog he called Bibiche, his mother who'd survived World War II by black marketing blood sausages, and his daughter. She was spoiled, a happy and singing girl. But when Mathilde was three, the new baby came. He was a fretful and screaming creature. Still, he was cooed over, that wizened turnip in blankets. Mathilde watched from under a chair, burning. Colic arrived and the baby in the house went piebald with vomit. Mathilde's mother walked around as if shattered. Four aunts, smelling of butter, came to help. They gossiped viciously, and their brother showed him his grapes, and the aunts chased Bibiche from the house with a broom. When the baby at last began to crawl, he got into everything, and his father had to build a gate at the top of the stairs. Mathilde's mother cried during the day in her bed when the children were supposed to be asleep. She was so tired. She smelled of fish. The baby liked best to crawl into his sister's bed and suck his thumb and twirl her hair, the snot in his nose catching so it sounded as if he were purring. During the night, she would slowly move both of their bodies toward the edge of the bed so that when he finally fell asleep and rolled onto his back, he'd tumble out and wake shrieking from the floor. She'd open her eyes in time to watch her mother rush in and pick the baby up with her swollen red hands and, scolding in whispers, carry him back to his own crib. Thank you.
Now for our fourth group of readers. In Young People's Literature, we have finalist Laura Ruby for Bone Gap, Balzer and Bray, a division of HarperCollins Children's Books. Poetry finalist Terrance Hayes, How to Be Drawn, Penguin Publisher. Nonfiction finalist Sally Mann, Hold Still, Little Brown, a division of Hachette Book Group. And fiction finalist Angela Flournoy, The Turner House, Houghton Mifflin Harcourt.
Hello. I am also, like everyone else, thrilled to be here. I am so glad that you are here, even after a break. My novel, Bone Gap, is something I like to consider a rural fairy tale. I'm going to read from an early part of the novel, and I'm just going to dive right in. This chapter is called Run. I'll be back. Rosa stood at the large picture window in the quiet suburban house and mouthed the words over and over as if giving them form could make them true. But that was foolish. Also foolish, waiting at the window, hoping to see the yard teeming with police officers, staring at the ceiling, listening for the sound of helicopters and the pounding of combat boots on the roof. No one had come. No one was coming, except for him. He would come, as he came every day, to ask the same question. Are you in love with me yet? At first, she'd answered his questions with questions. Who are you? Who are you really? What do you want? What is this place? What's wrong with you? But he would smile, that bland, pleasant smile, the smile of an uncle, a teacher, a clerk, all those men with all those teeth. You'll love me soon. You'll see. This was not the first place he'd brought her. The first place was a cavernous room so cold and empty and dark that she could not find the boundaries of it. It was the size of a cornfield. It was the size of a country. And all she could do was wander screaming through the blackness. Then one morning, she woke up and found herself in a giant bed in a sunny room with a plush blue armchair and a cherry armoire. He was sitting in one of the armchairs looking pleased with himself. I was wondering how long you'd sleep. Come, let me show you the house. She must have been drugged because she couldn't imagine how she'd gotten there, because she did let him show her the house. It was a large frame house with miles of slippery wood floors, a kitchen clad in stainless steel so shiny it burned, a living room with a fireplace and a giant TV. A picture window faced the street where other houses, identical except for their color, sat in a line like chastised children. Do you like it? He asked. I built it for you. Built it for her. Full-grown trees hunkered alongside the house, birds perching in the limbs as if posed. How long did it take to build a house? There are clothes in the closet upstairs, and the TV has every show, every movie. Watch anything you want. Again, the pleasant smile. The kitchen is stocked. You're looking a little thin. You should eat something. A long time ago, back in Poland, a horse had kicked a boy in the head, rendering him senseless and strange. This man had the same expression, cheerful, empty. He gestured to a painting hanging over the fireplace. It took her a moment to understand it was a portrait of her. She was standing in the middle of a verdant field, one blossom threaded through her fingers, another in her long, coiling hair. A ring of girls danced around her. In the picture, an invisible wind pulled at her white gown, outlining her body so vividly she didn't seem to be wearing any clothes at all. Rosa edged away from the fireplace, from the horrible painting over it, like an animal sidesteps a snake. He didn't notice, or if he did, he didn't care. He peered down at her from his great height, icy eyes on fire. She fought for breath, as if that stare was incinerating all the oxygen in the room, as if she would be consumed along with it. He said, "You're very beautiful." Rosa had heard this before, but had never scared her so much. "I want to marry you." When she finally spoke, she didn't say, "No one is so beautiful." She didn't say, "You're a kidnapper and a criminal and a madman." She didn't say, "I'm in love with someone else." She didn't say, "Please don't hurt me." What fell from her numb lips was what she'd said to a foolish boy she'd left in Poland. "I am too young to get married." "Oh," he said, head tilted, considering this new bit of information. "Well, I guess we'll have to wait until you're not too young." Thank you.
All right, it's a true joy to be here. This one's called Wig Frastic. It's after Ellen Gallagher. Sometimes I want a built-in scalp that looks and feels like skin, a form of camouflage protection against sunburn and frostbite, horse hair that covers the nightmares and makes me feel civilized. Somebody slap a powdered wig on me so I can hammer a couple sentences like Louis XIV, small and bald as a boiled egg, making himself taller by means of a towering hairpiece resembling a Corinthian column, or maybe a skyscraping kid with no play wig worn by someone playing NWA at a penthouse party with no black people. We up in the club humming, "Hey mama," while our numb skull caps underscore the brain's captivity. Somebody slap me. Norman Mailer's essay, "The White Negro, Superficial Reflections on the Hipster," never actually uses the word wigger. I'd rather say whack. It may be fruitful to consider me a philosophical psychopath. We club it in our wigs of pleas and longing. Ladies wear wigs of knots, knots of knots, would not, do not, cannot step to me. Wigs dipped in dye swirl on their scalps, off their scalps, side of scalps, their center parts and irrigated plaits. Flirty bangs dangle below a bow clip of sparkle. A lady places her bow about face to place her face in place, which is a placebo of place. Her face is a placebo. Let's wear ready-made wigs, custom-made wigs, hand-tied wigs, machine-made wigs. No Negro can saunter down a street with any real certainty that violence will not visit him, wrote Mailer. Bullets shout through the darkness. Dumb people are dangerous. Calamity pips come out of the woodwork and start to paddle their own canoes. This was the white dude's response to the death of Martin. Let's beat that apathy wig right off him. Let's get higher than God tonight, like the military wives of Imperial Rome, smiling in the blonde and red-haired wigs cut from the scalps of enemy captives. Somebody slap me. We are awash in liquor, watching the coils curl, curls coil, coils coil, curls curl on the girls. Non-slip, polyurethane, superfine lace, Isis wigs, Cleopatra wigs, big booty Judy wigs, under the soft radar streak music of climax, singing, the men all pause when we walk into the room. The men all pause, animals. The men all fangles, the men all woof woofs, a little bit lost, lust, lustrous, trustless, restless as the rest of us. In my life, the wigs eat me. The wish to live a while in the mind of another human, it is not inhuman. The wish to slide for a while inside another human, it is not inhuman. If you like I like, you should wear a hairpiece. It is peace of mind, it is artistic, it is a lightweight likeness, comfortable wash and wear, virtually looking and feeling with virtually no side effects. Let me hear you say, this wig is terrific, a colored despair wig for your colored despair. An economic despair wig, a sexual despair wig, a wig for expressive despair, political despair, a movable halo. New and improved, your wig can be set upon the older wig, just as the older wig was set when it was newer upon the wig beneath it. Where's your wig? Where your wig at? Your wig is terrific. All right, and then this is the last one. How to Draw an Invisible Man. I figured, you know, since I kind of think this is where Ralph Ellison was discovered, it's a poem for Ralph Ellison. How to Draw an Invisible Man. And then, when Ralph Ellison's corpse burst open, I discovered his body had been hoarding all these years a luscious slush, a sludge of arterial words, the raw and unsaid pages with their plots and propositions, with their arcs of intention and babbling, with their mumbling streams and false starts and their love and misanthropic thrust, tendons of syntax unraveled from his bones and intestinal cavities, the froth of singing, stinging, stinking ink, reams of script fraught with the demons, demagogues and demigods of democracy, demographies of vague landscapes, passages describing muddy river bottoms and elaborate protagonists crawling through a foliage greener than money in America before America thought to release anyone from its dream. The waterlogged monologues, one who is unseen speaks, burst suddenly from Ralph Ellison's body, and because I mean to live transparently, I am here, bear with me, describing the contents, the fictions envisioned by Emerson and immigrants, the dogmas, aboriginal progeny, scholastic recriminations, dementia, jubilee, hubris in Ralph Ellison, Duke Ellington's shadow, a paragraph on the feathered headdress of Marcus Garvey. Some of it was pornography. Some of it alluded to Negroes who believe educating black kids means teaching them to help white people feel comfortable. Some of it outlined the perks of invisibility, how we are obliged to eschew the zoo, the farm animals. It had something to do with captivity, flayed in the clinical light, The notes printed on the underside of his flesh were reversed, but readable, mirrored in the metal of the medical table, and I wanted to print it all properly in a posthumous book in the name of prosperity and proof the genius we believed he'd wasted had been waiting all these years for a simple death sentence to break free. Thank you.
I'm Sally Mann. I'm usually a photographer. So tonight, I thought I'd read a little piece about a trip I took back in the late 90s down south, down to Mississippi and Louisiana. The road out of Greenwood, Mississippi, slices through Loess Hills, soft as spoon bread, dropping down precipitously into the black ferment of the Delta. As I made my way down, oncoming drivers laboring up the steep lane opposite never failed to raise from the steering wheel a welcoming forefinger, the universal farmer's salute. And not just the congenial black faces behind the wheels of the low-slung Grands Prix and Catalinas, but also the good old boys in late model, multi-antennaed, white F-150 pickups, the NRA sticker on the back window just below the shotgun. It was just such a truck that I heard coming slowly across the fields where I was photographing a burned-down ruin of a plantation house. I knew that distinctive Ford engine noise. Not that I could see it, I couldn't. I was stuck under the darkroom curtains at the back of the Suburban with a newly sensitized plate that I wasn't about to ruin by looking out. The problem was I was in deep trespassing shit. I had been driving way out in the country, miles from any paved road, when I had seen these siren song columns. The home they once supported long burned to the ground, surrounded by live oaks trailing Spanish moss. Irresistible. The hitch was that they were behind a fence hung every several feet with no trespassing signs, and they purported to mean business. Trespassers will be shot. Violators will be shot. Survivors will be shot again. That kind of thing. Like Odysseus untied, tantalized by the vision of these columns, I pushed the Suburban through a gap I found in the barbed wire, sailed right in, and set to work. When I heard the pissed-off sound of that truck approaching, I knew I had more problems than a run-over dog. Under the dark cloth, I prepared my most ingratiating grin. The engine cut off, and everything was silent, save the ticking of cooling metal. After a few uneasy moments, the door opened, and I heard footsteps approaching. In the pause that followed, I imagined a gun barrel being raised by a Bull Connor-ish kind of man to that part of the dark cloth where my back, given the evidence of the legs below, would be. Awful nice day for taking a picture, the gentlest of southern voices spoke to the dark cloth. I couldn't believe my ears or my eyes when I emerged and saw him. He didn't look mean or angry at all. In fact, he had the benign, lazy look of somebody who'd gotten into a sizable mess of nookie the night before. Hiking himself up on his tailgate while I shot this picture, his eyes now intent beneath the tufted beam of his brow, he tore out page after page from a spiral-bound notebook on which he had drawn maps of other easily trespassable places. By the time I packed up my stuff, he had stacked a chatty-edged pile of scribbled pages on my passenger seat, promised to call his friends to ensure their help, and invited me back to meet the missus. The proverbial hospitality of the South may be selectively extended, but it is not a myth. The man was as gracious to this brazen trespasser as if I were Tocqueville back for a second visit. The whole trip was like that. Kind people, moldering ruins around every turn, and perfect weather, like some parallel state of grace. Everywhere I went, even the drabbest, most mongrelly backwash was enlightened by a glimmer of possibility. One evening, after a day of driving, I stopped at the edge of a raw expanse of logged-over red clay. From the open window of a nearby, newly built, fake plantation home, naked of trees and propped up with styrofoam columns, came the ravishingly beautiful, perfectly phrased chords of Beethoven's Pathetique Sonata. Transfixed, I leaned against the Suburban as the familiar notes, infused with a professional passion and restraint, drifted across the wasteland. Unrestrained myself, I walked up the porch steps, cupping my hands against the fly-specked window screen to discover within the pianist Simone Dinnerstein sitting before a chickering grand piano, attended on her right by a man who suffered the ravages of leprosy. At once, the humdrum and the miraculous, the inelegant and the ineffable. Thank you.
I am delighted to be here. Jobs Francis Turner held in his first 6 months in Detroit. 4. Jobs willfully abandoned. 1.5. Rooms rented. 1/2. Money sent to his wife Viola. $7. Alcohol consumed, many paychecks worth. Women slept with, 1. Number of times he slept with her, he stopped counting. Here's the truth about self-discovery. It is never without costs, not now in the age of create your own college majors, the Peace Corps and yoga retreats, and definitely not during World War II for a young black father newly migrated to a strange city. On the first freezing day in October, Francis discovered that the back of the bar on Bourbon had poor insulation. The patrons basked in warmth, but even Clydell's sizzling griddle could not prevent the kitchen from slipping into the 30s. On Clydell's advice, Francis spent the small amount of money he'd saved on a heavier coat to wear throughout his shift. No use. Whenever he pulled his hands out of the dishwasher, his knuckles ached like he had a bad case of early onset arthritis. He started spiking his coffee with bourbon to stay warm. Soon enough, he called Clydell, a stingy, pock-faced, crooked nigger under his breath, too loud, alas, and got the boot. It was a milestone. He'd never given words like that a go out of his own mouth, not directed at someone in particular. Never mind that Clydell's face wasn't marred by pox as much as heavily freckled, or that Francis hadn't quite cussed the man to his face. He felt one step closer to holding his own up here where men were crooked but pretended to be magnanimous. That feeling lasted until rent on his half room was due. To say that Francis slept with Odella Withers, the mistress of his boarding house, to secure free housing would not be accurate. He might have slept with her sooner had he seen her for longer than the moment when she handed over his bedding each night. Lonely as he was, Francis might have slept with one of the prostitutes he often saw smoking cigarettes and laughing alongside men in Paradise Valley bars. Had he thought he could afford one, Odella Withers had a wide mouth, very straight, square teeth, and bright pink gums. A mouth that made her look happier than Francis thought she was. Brown skin, not as dark as Viola's, but close. Francis Turner had a predilection for darker women. Perhaps it was a subconscious effort to prevent potential offspring from defecting to white. Or maybe it was because his own mother had been darker than his ill-fated beige father. Francis would sit in the armchair across from Odella in the boarding house's miserable little parlor and tell her all about his long day looking for work, how he'd hitched a ride down to River Rouge to see about work, only to have slots for the black men snapped up before he arrived. How he was in line to see about work at a foundry when an ambulance pulled up and word spread that a man had been nearly cooked alive. He told her about his week and a half working as a runner at the salt mine, how it reminded him of the time he'd traveled down to the Gulf with Reverend Tufts for a revival and felt his lungs fill with salty sea air miles before they got close enough to see the coast. He didn't tell her that he'd quit the salt mines because, sea air notwithstanding, he could not bear to be so far underground, the white walls dwarfing him, his own shadow a stranger as he hunched over and shuttled carts of supplies to white men, similar to how he imagined Hebrew slaves carting stone at Egyptian quarries. Few people think about the individual lives lost to make something huge, but Francis Turner thought about it often, had thought about it since the first time he read Exodus as a child. He feared he'd died in that dried up ocean cave, either from a blast gone wrong or plain old sun-starved misery. He found Odella reasonably versed in the Bible, and she knew about the goings on both overseas and in Detroit, thanks to her fondness for the radio. The Fibber McGee and Molly show had just come on the evening Francis decided to sit directly next to Odella and see what that wide mouth felt like pressed up against his own. They were in her little apartment downstairs with its banging radiator by the time the show's ham-fisted Johnson Wax commercial ended. Odella was the second woman Francis had ever slept with, and he was grateful for the experience, adultery be damned. So grateful, he repeated it as the act as often as she let him. Sleeping with her was not enough to absolve him of his rental obligations. "Everybody's got to pay rent, soldier," Odella said one morning, "even a body like yours." They drank half a pint of cheap bourbon the night before, and Odella stood in an ivory slip in front of her kitchenette, making a water and baking soda concoction for their hangovers. The thermostat outside read in the 20s, but Odella's basement apartment was always steamy, which she claimed was good for the lungs and bad for her hair. She liked to call Francis a soldier, and Francis never could decide whether she meant to make him feel brave or like a coward. She didn't ask him about back home, and he did not ask how she came to rent out a big old house by herself. He guessed her to be in her late 30s, but that guess was predicated only upon the way the skin between her breasts folded like a tiny accordion when she put them in a brassiere. The first job Odella found Francis involved painting houses with an outfit run by the same man who had painted the boarding house years before. This job Francis enjoyed. He had some skill in painting, thanks to summers spent touching up the church back home, and he got an opportunity to see more of the city than bus and streetcar fare could afford him. He tracked the pockets and neighborhoods where Negroes were living, and those where they seemed to have the best chance of encroaching. Out near 8 Mile in Wyoming, country life claimed its last foothold, but as much as a small farm and a modest house appealed to him, Francis knew Detroit was not the place for it. While outhouses and water pumps were ubiquitous back home, up here they heralded dire straits. He rode in the back of the truck and watched junk collectors traverse Black Bottom, their rickety carts overloaded with treasure scavenged from the many garbage piles that lined the back streets. 40 years later, he would think of these men when scrappers descended on his own neighborhood. He would imagine them running around the east side at night, placing the bits of metal they pried off of houses into the same rudimentary carts. The second job Odella found him was the most Jim Crow job in all of Detroit, or so Francis thought. Odella knew a few members of the Urban League who knew a member of the Nasarima Club, a social club for Negroes with status, American spelled backwards, she told him. Francis found this foreboding. The Nasarima man hired all of the caretakers for the cars that executives at a certain major manufacturer drove to work each day. They'd switched to defense building before the war, yet their own cars still received special attention. The company preferred Negroes with genteel mannerisms to serve the executives, but they settled for those with light skin and a pinch. Francis greeted the bosses when they came to work, washed and serviced the cars as needed, and drove them back out front when summoned. A stable boy for 20th century horses, a job Francis Turner was born to lose. Thank you.
And now for our final group of readers. In Young People's Literature, finalist Ali Benjamin, The Thing About Jellyfish, Little Brown Books for Young Readers, publisher. Poetry finalist Ross Gay, Catalog of Unabashed Gratitude, University of Pittsburgh Press. Nonfiction finalist Ta-Nehisi Coates, Between the World and Me, Spiegel and Grau. Reading for Ta-Nehisi Coates is Yona Harvey. And last fiction finalist, Karen E. Bender for Refund, Counterpoint Press.
Thank you. This is from the introduction to the book, Ghost Heart. A jellyfish, if you start to watch it long enough, begins to look like a heart beating. It doesn't matter what kind, the blood red atolla with its flashing siren lights, the frilly flower hat variety, or the near transparent moon jelly, Aurelia aurita. It's their pulse, the way they contract swiftly, then release, like a ghost heart, a heart you can see right through, right into some other world where everything you ever lost has gone to hide. Jellyfish don't even have hearts, of course. No heart, no brain, no bone, no blood. But watch them for a while. You'll see them beating. Mrs. Turton says that if you live to be 80 years old, your heart would beat 3 billion times. I was thinking about that, trying to imagine a number that large, 3 billion. Count back 3 billion hours, and modern humans don't exist, just wild-eyed cave people all hairy and grunting. 3 billion years? Life itself barely exists. And yet here's your heart, doing its job, one beat after the next, all the way up to 3 billion. But only if you get to live that long. It's beating when you're sleeping, when you're watching TV, when you're standing at the beach with your toes in the sand. Maybe while you're standing there, you're looking at sparkles of white light on dark ocean, wondering if it's worth getting your hair wet again. Maybe you notice that your bathing suit straps are just a little too tight on your sunburned shoulders, or that the sun is too bright in your eyes. You squint a little. You are as alive as anybody else right now. Meanwhile, the waves keep rolling over your toes, one after another, like a heartbeat almost, you can notice or not. And the elastic is digging in. And perhaps what you notice more than the sun or the straps is how cold the water is, or the way the waves create hollow places in the wet sand beneath your feet. Your mom is off at your side somewhere. She's taking a picture, and you know you should turn to her and smile. But you don't. You don't turn. You don't smile. You just keep looking out at the sea, and neither of you knows what matters most about this moment or what's about to happen. How could you? And the whole while, your heart just keeps going. It does what it needs to do, one beat after another, until it gets the message that it's time to stop, which might happen a few minutes from now, and you don't even know it. Because some hearts beat only about 412 million times, which might sound like a lot, but the truth is, it barely gets you 12 years.
Hello. No one said anything about this thing. Yes. Someone made that. I'm gonna read you two poems. So nice to be here, so fun to be with friends. It's lucky, feels very lucky. First poem is called Burial. And I have to ask you a question. Who in the audience has done something with their placenta? Hands? Seriously, yeah.
It was in the freezer for a while.
Oh, really? What do you do with it?
I think it got buried somewhere.
Okay, that's good. Someone else? Anyone? Yeah. What'd you do? Did you bury anything with it? Some other way? Oh, okay. All right, well, some people plant it with a tree. That works sometimes, sorry. Okay. Burial. You're right. The fertilizer is good. It wasn't a gang of dullards came up with chucking a fish in the planting hole, or some midwife got lucky with the placenta. Oh, I'll plant a tree here. And a sudden flush of quince and jam enough for months. Yes, the magic dust our bodies become casts spells on the roots about which someone else could tell you the chemical processes. But it's just magic to me. Which is why a couple springs ago, when first putting in my two bare root plum trees out back, I took the jar which has become my father's house, and lonely for him and hoping to coax him back for my mother as much as me, poured some of him into the planting holes. And he dove in, glad for the robust air, saddling a slight gust into my nose and mouth, chuckling as I coughed. But mostly he disappeared into the minor yawns in the earth, into which I placed the trees, splaying wide their roots, casting the gray dust of my old man evenly throughout the hole, replacing then the clods of dense Indiana soil until the roots and my father were buried, watering it all in with one hand while holding the tree with the other, straight as the flag to the nation of simple joy of which my father is now a naturalized citizen, waving the flag from his subterranean lair. The roots curled around him like shawls or jungle gyms, like hookahs or the arms of ancestors, before breaststroking into the xylem, riding the elevator up through the cambium and into the leaves where, when you put your ear close enough, you can hear him whisper, "Good morning." Where, if you close your eyes and push your face, you can feel his stubbly jowls. And good Lord, this year he was giddy at the first real fruit set and nestled into the 30 or 40 plums in the two trees, peering out from the sweet meat with his hands pressed against the purple skin like cathedral glass. And imagine his joy as the sun wizarded forth these abundant sugars, and I plodded barefoot and prayerful at the first ripe plum swell and blush, almost weepy, conjuring some surely ponderous verse to convey this bottomless grace, you know, oh father, kind of stuff. Hundreds of hot air balloons filling the sky in my chest, replacing his intubated body, listing like a boat keel side up, replacing the steady stream of water from the one eye, which his brother wiped before removing the tube, keeping his hand on the forehead until the last wind in his body wandered off, while my brother wailed like an animal, and my mother said, weeping, it's okay, you can go, honey. At all of which my father guffawed by kicking from the first bite buckets of juice down my chin, staining one of my two button-down shirts, the salmon-colored silk one, hollering, "There's more of that!" Almost dancing now in the plum, in the tree, the way he did as a person, bent over and biting his lip and chucking the one hip out and then the other with his elbows cocked and fists loosely made and eyes closed and mouth made trumpet when he knew he could make you happy just by being a little silly and sweet. And this is called "To the Fig Tree on 9th and Christian." Tumbling through the city in my mind without once looking up, the racket and the lug work, probably rehearsing some stupid thing I said or did, some crime or other. The city, they say, is a lonely place until, yes, the sound of sweeping and the woman, yes, with a broom, beneath which you are now too, the canopy of a fig, its arms pulling the September sun to it. And she has a hose, too, and so works hard, rinsing and scrubbing the walk, lest some poor sod slip on the silk of a fig and break his hip and not probably reach over to gobble up the perpetrator. The light catches the veins in her hands when I ask about the tree. They flutter in the air, and she says, "Take as much as you can, help me." So I load my pockets and mouth, and she points to the stepladder against the wall to mean more, but I was without a sack, so my meager plunder would have to suffice. And an old woman whom gravity was pulling into the earth loosed one from a low-slung branch, and its eye wept like hers, which she dabbed with a kerchief as she cleaved the fig with what remained of her teeth. And soon there were 8 or 9 people gathered beneath the tree, looking into it like a constellation, pointing, "Do you see it?" And I am tall, and so good for these things. And a bald man even told me so. When I grab 3 or 4 for him, reaching into the giddy throngs of yellow jackets, sugar stone, which he only pointed to, smiling and rubbing his stomach. I mean, he was really rubbing his stomach, like there was a baby in there. It was hot. His head shone while he offered recipes to the group using words which I couldn't understand. And besides, I was a little tipsy on the dance of the velvety heart rolling in my mouth, pulling me down and down into the oldest countries of my body, where I ate my first fig from the hand of a man who escaped his country by swimming through the night and maybe never said more than five words to me at once, but gave me figs. And a man on his way to work hops twice to reach at last his fig, which he smiles at and calls baby. Come here, baby, he says, and blows a kiss to the tree, which everyone knows cannot grow this far north, being Mediterranean and favoring the rocky, sun-baked soils of Jordan and Sicily. But no one told the fig tree or the immigrants. There is a way the fig tree grows in groves. It seems to want to hold us. Yes, I am anthropomorphizing, goddammit. I have twice in the last 30 seconds rubbed my sweaty forearm into someone else's sweaty shoulder, gleeful, eating out of each other's hands on Christian Street in Philadelphia, a city like most, which has murdered its own people. This is true. We are feeding each other from a tree at the corner of Christian and 9th. Strangers, maybe never again. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm very honored to be here and to read on behalf of my friend Ta-Nehisi Coates. The boy with the small eyes reached into his ski jacket and pulled out a gun. I recall it in the slowest motion, as though in a dream. There the boy stood with the gun brandished, which he slowly untucked, tucked, then untucked once more. And in his small eyes, I saw a surging rage that could, in an instant, erase my body. That was 1986. That year, I felt myself to be drowning in the news reports of murder. I was aware that these murders very often did not land upon the intended targets, but fell upon great aunts, PTA mothers, overtime uncles, and joyful children. Fell upon them random and relentless like great sheets of rain. I knew this in theory, but could not understand it as fact until the boy with the small eyes stood across from me, holding my entire body in his small hands. The boy did not shoot. His friends pulled him back. He did not need to shoot. He had affirmed my place in the order of things. He had let it be known how easily I could be selected. I took the subway home that day, processing the episode all alone. I did not tell my parents. I did not tell my teachers. And if I told my friends, I would have done so with all the excitement needed to obscure the fear that came over me in that moment. I remember being amazed that death could so easily rise up from the nothing of a boyish afternoon, billow up like fog. I knew that West Baltimore, where I lived, that the north side of Philadelphia, where my cousins lived, that the south side of Chicago, where friends of my father lived, comprised a world apart. Somewhere out there beyond the firmament, past the asteroid belt, there were other worlds where children did not regularly fear for their bodies. I knew this because there was a large television resting in my living room. In the evenings, I would sit before this television, bearing witness to the dispatches from this other world. There were little white boys with complete collections of football cards, and their only want was a popular girlfriend, and their only worry was poison oak. That other world was suburban and endless, organized around pot roasts, blueberry pies, fireworks, ice cream sundaes, immaculate bathrooms, and small toy trucks that were loosed in wooded backyards with streams and glens. Comparing these dispatches with the facts of my native world, I came to understand that my country was a galaxy, and this galaxy stretched from the pandemonium of West Baltimore to the happy hunting grounds of Mr. Belvedere. I obsessed over the distance between that other sector of space and my own. I knew that my portion of the American galaxy, where bodies were enslaved by a tenacious gravity, was black, and that the other liberated portion was not. I knew that some inscrutable energy preserved the breach. I felt, but did not yet understand, the relation between that other world and me. And I felt in this a cosmic injustice, a profound cruelty, which infused an abiding, irrepressible desire to unshackle my body and achieve the velocity of escape. Thank you.
Thank you for including me among these amazing, amazing writers. I am so happy to be here. I'm going to read a scene from my story, Refund. What you need to know is that Clarissa and her family live in Tribeca, a few blocks from Ground Zero, in a rent-subsidized apartment. It's a few weeks after September 11th, and she's taking her son to a preschool that their family cannot afford at all. She took Sammy to his first day of school. She walked down the street past the tape flyers. The local day spa was offering free massages for firemen and policemen. A neighborhood restaurant offered a $25 prefix, macaroni and roast beef. Donations to Ladder 8 for missing firemen accepted. Dozens of Xerox faces of the missing clung to lampposts wrapped with tape. They stared into the street. Loving husband and father, our dear daughter, worked on the 87th floor, worked at Windows on the World. Please call. The preschool was a block north of the wooden police barricades that separated regular life from the crumpled heap of buildings, the endless black smoke. Her stroller rattled past them and through the doors of the preschool. The school staff floated around, greeting everyone with an unnerving intimacy by their first names. Sammy darted into his classroom, and she stood with a cloud of mothers. They had walked to school under the smoky, foul skies, wearing leather coats in blue and orange. It seemed a paltry, mean decision, deciding what to wear, waking up and hearing the broken buildings falling into the boats. They had decided to dress up. Their hair was frosted golden and brown, and they were beautiful, and when they left, they cupped hands over their mouths. "Have you gone out to dinner yet?" she heard one mother ask another. "You wouldn't believe the good deals down here. Plus, you can get reservations. Prefix at Chanterelle, $35. Incredible. Plus, you've money for a good bottle of wine." "The Independence has a special, eat American," said another. "The waitstaff is fast and gracious. They have the most exquisite apple pie." Clarissa closed her eyes and rubbed her face, wondering if she should admire these mothers' resilience or be appalled. "We were refugees at the plaza," she heard another mother say. "They had a special for everyone living below canal. We had to go. Our place was covered in dust. We started throwing up, and I knew we had to get out. It cost a ton to get it cleaned. Should we stay or go? Can someone just tell me?" She whirled around looking. The teacher came by. "The children are doing well," she said. Do you want to say bye before you go? Now Clarissa swerved through the room. Your child was not in the world, and then he was suddenly part of it. She crouched and breathed his clean, heartbreaking smell. I'm going by, she said. Her child ignored her. Slowly she stood up. In the office off the main hallway, the in-house psychologist was holding a drop-in support session in which parents could talk about their feelings about sending their children to preschool three blocks from the site. Clarissa stood with the group clustered around the psychologist. One mother said, "My child screamed the whole way here, saying she was scared and didn't want to go, and I dropped her off, but then, well, I wonder, is she right to be scared?" "Why is she right?" asked the psychologist. "Well, because," called Clarissa from the back. "You have to believe it is safe," said the psychologist. "You tell them a kid's job is to go to school, and a parent's job is to keep you safe." "But what if we don't know if it's safe?" Clarissa asked. "Where is it safe?" the psychologist said. "Here, Brooklyn, Vermont, Milwaukee?" The parents leaned toward her, awaiting an answer. "You have to tell them a little lie," the psychologist said. Thank you.
And now we've come to the end of our evening. I want to thank everybody for coming. You've made this night so special. Thanks to the volunteers, the staff, and a special thanks to Luis Jaramillo, Laurelyn Turner, and the New School for hosting the event. And one more big round of applause for our finalists. That was wonderful.